So in the part one and part two of our talk of we saw a lot of commands, we ran a lot of commands. Okay. The similar thing, like we'll just recall our last few commands which we have run. Okay. So there are two different kind of commands. One is a Docker machine commands and another is the Docker client commands. Okay. So Docker machine commands are nothing but Docker machine, Docker dash machine. They would be like Docker dash machine ls, or it would be Docker dash machine ls for listing out all the containers. Okay, Docker machine, we set up environment for the client environment. If my host name is default, then I'll choose as default. Okay, or my host name is Ubuntu VM, which is running on my virtual box, then I'll mention like this. Okay, so those were Docker machine commands which we have. And Docker, we went through a few of Docker client commands called Docker images, which lists out all of the images which are available in the in my this in my account. And Docker RMI, okay, remove an image, okay, and this is the image number 03B4. Okay, if it is you are removing Hello World image from this, then you will be giving this image ID 05A. Or you can give the image name itself, okay, it will also work. And you can see the 05A RMI, I'm removing 05A. Okay, so that's what, after that you can check. So it's not there, no Docker images are there after we removed it. Okay, similarly the Docker CLI also runs few other commands, and which starts with Docker. Okay, and Docker run dash IT. Okay, IT is nothing but IT flag, which means that interactive mode. Okay, so when you add an IT to your command, so it actually adds an interactive mode, so that if you have any something like command.exe which you are running inside a Windows Server core, okay, then you can call that particular same .exe and you can interact directly into that session. So from Docker bash session, you can directly transport into the same session which is running inside the host, inside the container basically. So what we are doing is this, like Microsoft slash Windows Server core is an image which is available, and on this particular image we are actually running. Okay, and we are saying that start an interactive session where I need to have cmd.exe. So once this particular Windows Server core runs up, okay, it runs on a container, and then inside the container we can manipulate the, since this is an OS, Windows Server Core OS, lightweight OS, so we can interact with any of the like file, we can copy files into it, into www root folder, anything. For that we need to have cmd.exe. So once we have cmd.exe called up, okay, so from bash session we will be transferred to the command prompt session. Once we are in the command prompt session of that particular container, we can actually open any of, we can create directories, we can modify files in that particular directories, everything else. And if you don't want to have an interactive session, you just want to run an application which is hosted inside this particular Docker container which you are running, so you will just go and directly just take an image. So this image is basically, it has an application files, okay, and all the dependency files which need to be run, which need to run this particular application. Okay, and this particular application is Windows Server Core, it's an OS itself on which you can actually host in its IIS. Okay, that's also possible on Dockers. So for this what we do is like it's just an ASP.NET application details, so it would have all necessary DLLs or extensions or runtime libraries which would be required to run this particular website, ASP.NET website. Maybe the .NET framework is is an importance, or instead of .NET framework it can use .NET Core framework, okay, which is very lightweight, and it can run and it would host this particular ASP.NET application on 8080. So dash P is port and this is interactive mode. Dash P, why it is said is like because it says that we are defining a port And there are two ports you can see. One is the port where this particular container is mapped, and another is the host port itself. Okay, so the container port and the host port need to be mapped, and mostly they would be, you know, similar, so that it won't create any confusion. And then whenever the call goes, it actually, you make a call to the IP address or wherever it is hosted, it goes to this particular IT, and then it redirects to the host port, and then the host port would redirect to the container port on which it is hosted, the container is hosted. Okay, so that is the meaning of IT there. And if you're looking for any running containers, what you can do is, like, you can type docker ps minus all, or you can also type docker ps minus a. That is also sufficient. Okay, and it will list out all the, you know, running containers which you have. Okay, once we come at, you know, complete all this session, I mean complete all this statement, we'll run here in the lab session. And what you can do is, like, you can create an image. Okay, you can create an image from a running container, or you can build an image using docker build command as well. Okay, so committing a container after it has run. So what you would do is, like, here we first drop a container. Okay, and we actually check for any, you know, running containers or not. If it is went into exited state, we can make it as docker commit name of the stopped container and the repo on which, like, you want to make an image out of it, right? So that's a command. So we say docker commit my repo repository. So my repo is the Azure guy, and underneath we'll be having this particular my app. So this repo is nothing but the repository which you are persisting on Docker Hub. Okay, you can you can actually duplicate your repo in your local as well. So when you commit, this particular changes would go into local, and when we publish, it goes into your Docker Hub account. Okay, so this is my .NET Core app which I have already hosted, and I've just given the name of this particular app as well. And if you want to use the build command, right? So this is for the first part where you have a running container and you can build an image out of it. Okay, so when you do this commit, it's actually taking a running container and building an image out of it. And if you want to do use a build command to manually build your image, what you need to do is, like, you need to create a Docker file. So the Docker file would I'll show you how does it look. My Docker file would, this is my visual code which I've just installed because I wanted to show up demo on this, but I was not able to, I didn't have any Visual Studio code on this, Visual Studio ID on this installed on this. So I just went and download VS Code, which is very lightweight. It's easy for editing your work files, everything. So this is my up-to-date directory, and this is a particular project which I have developed. And okay, this is a particular ASP.NET project which actually are running on .NET Core framework. Okay, so I have something called as a Docker file in it, and this particular, let me hide them. Yes, so you can see my complete project. I have something Docker file. So when I click on the Docker file, it starts with from. So the first line of every Docker file would be pointing to an image. Okay, so one particular image is, this is ASP.NET Core build 2.0. okay, this is the image which it is targeting, and then we have all the commands, and these all the commands are nothing but this would create up or push all or get all the dependency or runtime libraries, whatever needed for running an application. Okay, for here it need to run ASP.NET app. For that it would get all of the dependency files in these lines, and then, like, it will also show, like, where does the successful build should go and sit in. It should sit in app/out folder. Okay, and it will also show what is a base image it will, this particular container or the base container where this particular application will be running. Okay, the my base image is ASP.NET Core build 2.0. We'll take this base image. On top of that, we'll push dissolve files and then run our .NET application inside underneath it. Okay, that is the VS Code in it. So we have something called as for here for a hello world sort of program. What we have is like we have a like for this IS. This is Windows Server Core. Okay, Windows Server Core OS which we are talking about. Windows Server Core OS image which we are talking about. And in here, what we need to do is like I come to here and I'll create a Docker file. I'll save from Microsoft IIS. It's a base image, IIS image, and working directory is www root folder. And inside that, I'm adding an index.html. Okay, so that is only it is saying it will get an image and it will create a work directory. And then inside the work directory to create index.html. Afterwards, what will happen is like we can run this particular Docker build command by saying build Docker build minus t and my sample image. Okay, and that's a file. And there, once that is done, like it will build this particular our particular solution, and then it would list out. That would be run, and you can access this particular, you know, the build wherever, like when you say or run quick start terminal, okay, you'll get an IP, okay, or you can just click on something called as Docker machine IP, okay, or there is another command called as or you can run Docker inspect something, Docker machine inspect the container name or the container ID. Okay, but clarify it, which can return my IPs as well. So on that particular IP and the port number, our application, this particular application would be running, as we have already built. And when we run the something called as, before that we need to run this particular command. For that, what we do is like we type Docker run, and my is the name of my image, my sample image. So it would have made certain, you know, container out of it. Like we need to run it, and then it will make a container. So my I know this image ID is my sample image. I'll just run my sample image. Okay, so that would run my. The run my this particular image and would, you know, the host of a container on which our application is running. After that, like we also learn how to, you know, get Docker images. Okay, we just type Docker images and it would pull out all the images which are inside your machine locally, and we something called as Docker pull and the name of the image which would return the images. Like if you want to check, then what I do is I'll just type Docker images. Okay, see these many images I'm running on, and I can pull out any of the images if they are not here. So for that, what I do is like something called the Docker search. Okay, it needs one more parameter. I'll search for Docker search, and I made something called as I published a image there under the show guy. So let's see whether it can find a published image. Yes, so you can see that for Docker search the show guy, which I have created image recently with .NET Core app. Okay, so this particular thing says that this is under the show guy, my .NET Core app. Okay, and description in Docker images built on .NET Core. Okay, so that's how like you can build your own image and publish into Docker Hub as well. Okay, once you make them available on the Docker Hub, you can actually pull at any time. So I can see, you can see that you can Docker search the show guy. I just typed it and I got all of the images which are underneath this particular show guy. The same thing we can search from various vendors. You can search from Kitematic as well, or you can search from Microsoft. The various images available from Microsoft, you can see these many images are available from Microsoft as of now, and the list grows upon, because each and every person, they develop their own image and they publish certain images and they make certain images available privately inside their firm. Okay, so we'll let you know when I'll let you know what is the benefit of doing public or private, okay, in later sessions. Or you can remove an image stating that the Docker RMI, it is RMI, remove an image and the name of the stopped container. Okay, this is stopped container. This is removing an container, possibly. Okay, and removing an image is the same thing. It doesn't make, it's not, there's not, nothing more difference. And what it is like, so it is just removing an image is easy, where you need to add RMI stopped. There's no stopped, it's an image ID, name of the image, name, or even ID works, which that's it. So, and the other commands which we have is like like which we ran already, docker ps, docker psa, which list outs all the containers, docker search we just implemented, and docker pull we just implemented docker pull as well here. Okay, and there's something called as docker run, where you would, you know, we are trying to host. We'll show up these all commands, you know, after like when we are executing a particular application, .NET Core app. Docker stop you can see on a container ID, docker remove image you can see on a image ID, docker ps minus aq minus f status exited, it would, you know, list out all of the exited containers, the stopped containers you can say, which are which can be listed out. Okay, and if you want to remove a stopped container, then you can use this particular command, which forcefully, you know, removes it. And there's something called as docker execute interactive mode cmd, which we have already discussed, cmd.exe. okay, our cmd should also work fine. Okay, and like I've said, right, like we can enter into interactive mode into certain like this is with respect to Windows Server Core, which we have container, we can enter into it, we can make a directory list out of it, and then we can enter into initpub, and then we can enter into www root folder, and then we can make changes, add file changes, make changes, and then copy files, everything. We can create a file and write a content inside, and we can exit out of it, and we can also inspect on which particular, you know, basically for the container ID, on which IP this particular site is running in. Okay, so I've said before, right, docker inspect container ID, so that would give you the IP. Okay, if you want to make an image out of it, you say docker commit container ID, and you would give the name of the new image which you want to make out of this particular container ID. That's it. Docker commit, and this is the ID. Okay, on which I'm actually committing the changes, and we can get the docker images, you know that, and these are the same like commands, tags, everything. You can, we can build our own image like that we have already talked, right? We can build out of running container, or we can build out of just I have not like I've carried out this step, and just it's just sort of a review. So that is it, and then we, you know, entered into something next level. So where we'll try to understand what is a layered file system, what are containers and volumes, and how we can connect source code into our container so that it can take up the latest code, whatever we put in source code. That would be, you know, a DevOps implementation, and we can hook a container volume to source code as well. Okay, and because as we know that containers are, you know, are run at runtime, and they can be stopped and removed. If I'm stopping and removing, then, you know, my source code can be deleted when I stop, or even when I delete from my host. Okay, so from my Docker host. So my Docker host, which is in virtual, you know, any of the VMware or, you know, virtual box or somewhere it's running, and my host contains have the real memory. Okay, or it's a native operating system for this particular containers. Okay, but my container doesn't remember right where exactly I need to store data. If I am getting removed, then where I'll be storing this particular data. So for that only we have something called as volumes. Okay, and I'll let you know how does that work. And think of a scenario like the source code is in somewhere in Git or in VSTS anywhere else, but how do we connect that into container? Okay, and for that, before going to that, what we'll discuss something else is like we can create a container volume. Okay, and then like for solving this particular issue, like we can create the terminology called as volumes, right? So we can go ahead and create something called as volumes or container volumes. So don't confuse with the name container volume. The container volume, okay, this is the volume or the space would be created, but the volume is not created on container because container is virtual, right? So the volume is created on the node or the on the host itself. Okay, it's not created exactly inside the container, because if it is created inside the container, then when you remove the container, we will lose the data inside it, underneath it. Okay, whether it's data of application which was running or other thing. Okay, we can create a container volume that points to the source code. Okay, if we do this, then you know the source code, we can the data or the code can be plugged in from source code with either Git or VSTS and put onto my container volume. And my container volume, since it exists on host, which means that it physically exists on my this particular virtual box host or Ubuntu host. Okay, and Ubuntu host is occupying some space in my machine, so it has a physical existence. So it says that the source code can come into my the container volume, and then we can add a source code into custom. And what we can do is like we can add our source code into custom image as well, that is used to create a container. Okay, so what we can do is like we can create a container volume which can dynamically can take code from Git or VSTS, or we run a container, we can add a code to it, we can add a code onto our container and boot up our application on from it, like building it and running it. Once it runs as a container, we can build an image out of it. When we build an image out of it, it would take the source code which was used to run that particular application as well. Okay, these are the two methods by which we can connect a source code into my container. And one more interesting thing is like so whatever images, like this is Ubuntu machine, okay, and this Ubuntu machine which I'm running, Ubuntu Docker, a Linux machine this is, okay, or it can be an Ubuntu machine which I'm running, and it's running having these particular four images. Okay, how does these images are getting interacted via container, or how the container is using these particular images is like, think of an example like container is sort of instance, and these images are sort of .vhd files. Okay, so my VM runs on my VHD files. Okay, similarly there's something called as container layer which actually sits between container. So it's thin read write layer which actually checks up policies, everything, security, everything when a container writes on something onto my image which is inside my host. Okay, and you can create multiple containers out of single instance, single image as well. There's no restriction. Okay, and you can make multiple changes. You can give particular single image to multiple developers sitting across the world, and they can modify their changes and check in back, or they can create their own image out of it and then check in back that particular image to Docker Hub or anywhere, so that I can go and access it and put that particular image again back to my Ubuntu machine, which can be available for next further users as well to develop. That's a beautiful implementation of Docker. And and what is volume is, it's a special type of directory in a container, typically referred to as data volume. Okay, so it's like getting up some data disk or data disk space for putting on some shared files. So this particular data container volume can be shared among all the containers. Okay, and updates to an image won't affect a data volume. Okay, And then data volumes are persisted even after the container is deleted, since it's getting hosted on a host, a Docker host. That's why even if we delete a container, it will not affect us. There's something called as volume, like the same thing. The how does you know internally volume overview or volume or the volume container is there is like it would create a host inside the host. It would create a it would mount a folder where the shared files would be there, basing upon each of the you know the containers whatever it's running. So this particular mount folder would be mapped to slash where www root folder on the container. So which goes directly onto the you know the AS of this particular thing, and then people can access this particular page. So in order to create a data volume, you need to run this particular command, which I have added in the slide. And the node in here is nothing but the image name. Okay, and then like my image name. So I have something called as my container image in here, and I'll just give an example here so that you can understand it more. So I have an image called as my container image, which I'm trying to run at the port 8080 is a host port, and this is a container port. Okay, so when you run, you run on something called as localhost. Or you can give an IP and then you type 8080. Okay, there where you'll be running your application. Or you can the IP slash 8080. It should give you the application URL. So you can check also as well. You can run Docker inspect as well for finding your IP and then as well like the source code mapping as well. Okay. So you can customize this volume. Okay, you can put your source folder onto the Docker host and then give that to containers as well. That's also possible. And for that, you need to for customizing a data volume, you need to run this particular command dash v password. You need to pwd. You need to paste, and there's something called as var www node. Okay, and locating a volume is like same thing. Like you have run Docker inspect after this particular activity, right? The same thing you can carry out after this, and then you can see the source file location and the destination location. So the destination sits on my container and the source sits on my image. And the same way you can try hooking a node.js source code as well. For that you need to go to the node.js site and then install the node.js framework first. And then once it says that it would install all the you know necessary files and the default path, and then you can run few of these commands and you can run an application using node.js application. You can run the same thing like again we ran this particular commands, the Docker machine commands. You can see Docker machine IP, environment, everything. You can go through them. And we try to pull, we try to run an image, images we try to populate and Docker PS with it. Okay, the same thing you can go and go through them, run these commands, and then let me know how does they are. Okay, there's something called as containers which we had talked about in the past. Let me go through a basic you know the importance of container itself. Okay, I'll just name it as importance of containers. Why a container is important is like previously in old days we had something called as whenever we need to you know run an application or web app, then we need to have a server. Okay, so it leads to you know it has a lot of upfront cost. You need to buy this particular server. You need to put on ongoing expenses, OPEX charges also, operation expenses also, because you need to run on it. The server should run on power and on licenses, on software, so which has you know capital capex, and I mean which has, you know, capital and opex expenses as well, and then, you know, the procurement also lead a lot of time. Okay, so then the VMware revolution came, where actually each server, you know, instead of, like, in this particular server, in order to have isolation, we used to use one particular server for one particular customer. Okay, but since we didn't have any isolation to host one more application in here, so that, like, one particular customer can't access data of another customer. Okay, application can't go in trouble with another application, but you can host multiple application on a single server. Okay, but that was an issue, and which was, you know, rectified or modified, or, you know, gained or phased out by VMware Revolution. So what is a VMware Revolution? Is a VMware is a company who had actually bought this virtualization technology into the market, as Docker is now a bigger revolution. VMware was a revolution few years back. What it does is, like, on a single server you can have host a VMware, okay, and on top of VMware you can host multiple application, and which actually provided, you know, application isolation as well. So there's no problem with customers, they can maintain standards, and their application is not, or data or application is not engulfed with another, you know, another party customer's application as well. Okay, so instead of VMware, in Windows we have something called Hyper-V. Hyper-V allows multiple apps per server as well. Okay, single server could host multiple apps, and so this is a structure, like, how does the VMware, you know, host the application, different application on a single server. A single server, we have VMs, virtualized VMs, like, it's not nothing but the VMs are, you know, they would be running on this particular virtual, you know, VMware. Okay, this is a VMware, not exactly VM, or it can be Hyper-V. Okay, on top of Hyper-V, like this virtual box, I'm running on top of my server, right? This is my laptop. On top of that laptop, I'm running a box, virtual box. These are virtual box. On top of virtual box, I have something called as Ubuntu. Okay, so these can be Ubuntu, Windows, or any other OS. And on top of that particular each OS's, I have an application running inside this particular guest operating system. Okay, so these are guest operating system, and this is native operating system. Okay, on top we are running this particular all of the apps. So since I have an isolation here from OS level, so there would be, you know, no interference of this particular application pool getting interacted or leaked, data leaked into another application pool, or a person log getting RDP into it can actually, you know, go and RDP into another application pool, pool data. Okay, that's impossible. So, and then we had container architecture in place. So which actually is, you can know that if you have multiple OSs, you have a native OS which is running, it can be Windows 8 or anything else. On top of that you have Hyper-V, on top of that you have virtual boxes or something, and then you have OSs, guest OSs running onto it. So which actually, you know, have a lot of licensing cost. You need to pay for this and to pay for this as well. Okay, and then it, you know, this OSs, guest OS are a lot of resource intensive processes. Because they would, you know, that they would be taking up RAM if this particular server or laptop is of, just a minute, if this particular laptop is of around the 10 GB or 16 GB of RAM, it would, you know, divide by 4 on top across this particular OS. Even not 4, it would, you know, it can distribute at max of 2.5 GB or 2 GB of RAM to each and every OS, on which actually they can run simultaneously. Okay, so but containers, what they did is, like, they have actually removed the Hyper-V or any of the virtual box or anything, and they have removed the guest OS's concept as well. It just runs natively on a single operating system, which is my native operating system, and then it had, you know, kept us with lot of space which we were using for each of, you know, hard disk which we were allocating this particular single OS's which were running on virtual box or VMware or Hyper-V. Okay, but by container you can save a lot of space, and on top of containers, inside the containers we can run our applications. Okay, so my container would engulf all of the runtime libraries and image runtime libraries and dependency files, everything, even the SDKs, everything underneath it, and on top of which my application can run fine without any issues. So I'll talk about the Docker container registry tomorrow. Okay, so let's go and